1953, Lincoln Academy has had a Faculty Shield competition, won first by the class of 1954, one of the great classes in Lincoln Academy. I want to congratulate the class of 2020. It was really a team effort, I feel, by their advisors and their students, beginning a homecoming. And they came from behind the very last day, and it's my pleasure to hand over the Faculty Shield plaque to Ellie, the president of the class of 2020. Congratulations.
Thank you, Mr. Page.
You're welcome.
Day 2020! We did it!
homecoming, Baba. Congratulations to the class of 2020. Like you 50 years ago, I was preparing for graduation at Lincoln Academy as well. Now for two scholarships from the Page family. The Julie Page Scholarship recognizes a senior who has distinguished themselves through volunteering their time to school and community. Julie L.A. class of 1973 lost a courageous one-year battle with ovarian cancer in 2014. We want her and her unselfish hours of volunteerism to be remembered and for others like you to be inspired by her service. Julie and husband Scott helped maintain a very high standard of volunteering in the Gorham High School community. She was a longtime member of the Gorham High School Booster Club and was its president for 5 years. Today, an annual golf tournament in her memory has raised over $50,000 to support the Jimmy Fund's fight against cancer. Her spirit of living goes on. The recipient of this scholarship has been a dedicated member of the senior class who has taken great pride in volunteerism in her 4 years at Lincoln Academy. It is my pleasure on behalf of the Cleveland A. Page family and the Scott Bernheimer family to award the Julie Page Bernheimer Scholarship to Ellie Matthews. And now for the Cleveland A. Page Scholarship. It is my pleasure on behalf of the Cleveland A. Page family to award the Cleveland A. Page Scholarship to a senior who has for 4 years displayed excellence in academics, athletics, and music. Efforts in these three areas by LA students contribute to making Lincoln Academy the great school that it is. Academics. My father was the valedictorian of the class of 1942. He attended Bowdoin College and practiced law for over 60 years in Lincoln County. Athletics. My father was an avid sports fan. Athletics was always of great importance in the Page family. Through significant contributions of his children and grandchildren, state championship banners hang in Gorham High School, Wiscasset High School, and Lincoln Academy. Music. His greatest passion was music. He was a noted musician in the area playing dance jobs throughout the state and beyond. He was probably best known statewide for playing Sweet Georgia Brown as Lincoln Academy basketball players took the floor in over 5 decades. For excellence in academics, athletics, and music, it is my pleasure to award this year's Cleveland A. Page Scholarship to JoJo Madden. Congratulations, seniors, class of 2020. I would like to know the senior quote. That's right, Santa T. Lander. Every exit is an entrance somewhere. And now for your final quote I'd like to give on class night, and that is, whatever you are, be a good one. Best of all, to Lincoln Academy, to the class of 2020.
Good evening, students, parents, guardians, family members, faculty, staff, and invited guests. I'm pleased to be able to begin our baccalaureate service for the class of 2020. As the newest member of our community here, I'm excited to hear the speakers that you, the class of 2020, have chosen for this service. But before I introduce them to our audience, I want to ask something of you. I want you to take time tonight to breathe and appreciate the moment in which you find yourself. I want you to take some time to reflect on the efforts that you and those around you have invested in the course of your high school career. When we think of the word reflection, most of us think of a mirror, our face staring back at us. If we were all to hold a mirror up right now, we would certainly see the physical structures of our faces, cheekbones, lips, our chin and nose, eyebrows and ears. No doubt that all of us would also see a bit more worry in our faces, a bit more strain from the events of the past 2 months and past several days, and in our eyes, I am certain we will see some emotion welling at the corners. Joy in the accomplishment that will be recognized tomorrow, sadness in the knowledge of moving on from this community, and love for those around you that have helped you find your path here at Lincoln Academy. My wish for you tonight is that you will take some time to slow down, appreciate and reflect in the moment with us here tonight. Even though virtual, we are here together across the state and around the world in a way that we've never been before. Tonight, take some time to listen to these distinguished guests that you have chosen. Let the emotions come as they may and savor this moment for what it is and what it will be in the fabric of your lives. Speakers tonight will include Pastor Mary Lee Harris of the Damariscotta Baptist Church, Seth Anderson, a longtime Academy teacher of English who is retiring this year, Eric Duffy, our beloved and iconic school nurse, Thomas Cothey, former English teacher, 5 years at the Academy, who returns at the invitation of the class of 2020, Kate Aldrich, class of 1992, who is a renowned opera singer and Damariscotta native who lives in Rome, and Ryan Gall, also from the class of 1992, who is an actor and a comedian who lives in Los Angeles. Welcome all.
Hi, I'm Pastor Mary Lee Harris. Congratulations, class of 2020. Your class will go down in history as a class who was forced by a worldwide pandemic to reinvent the last trimester of your senior year. Many externals have been stripped away, making things around you seem dark. But please believe these days will pass. So despite the struggles you've been forced to endure, be reminded, you each have a light that shines for everyone to see. And although you may sense uncertainty and darkness around you, even the smallest light shines bright in the darkness. You've been blessed with this light, and may your light grow more resilient and stronger through the adversity and through all that life may offer you. May you shine.
Hello and congratulations to the Lincoln Academy class of 2020. It's Mr. Cothey, yes, a little unshorn, a little unkempt, but honored, humbled, and thrilled to take some small part in celebrating this moment with you. When I first heard and had the chance to speak to you, I immediately thought about some of my more devious students from the class of 2020, using this opportunity to exact revenge on me for those pesky on-demand writing prompts. Hey, you guys, let's see if Mr. Cothey can write a life-affirming speech during an unprecedented global pandemic. Well, you know what? Challenge accepted. Like many of you, I wish the circumstances could have been different, but I enjoyed reminiscing about our time together and thinking about what makes the class of 2020 special. Initially, I thought of your triumphs in music, athletics, and academics, those profound iSearch papers about nuclear physics, jazz music, the psychology of dreams, and the delicate social dynamics of a cheerleading squad. Then I remembered Gatsby. I associate the great Gatsby with the class of 2020, not only because it mediated the relationships I developed with many of you, but also because it reminds me of some of my fondest memories of being in class with you and learning from you. Also, as I'm going to explain, the class of 2020 changed my mind about this book, or rather a specific character in the book, and taught me a valuable lesson about the importance of recognizing the humanity in others. So let's flash back to sophomore year. About halfway through the novel, as you might remember, you were asked a deceptively simple question. Is Gatsby, in fact, great? Responses to this question tend to vary from class to class, but I remember one year in two of my classes when you were sophomores, it became deeply unpopular to admit that you maybe thought even a little bit that Gatsby was, in fact, great. In those classes, affirming Gatsby's greatness became an extreme minority position adopted by only the boldest and most contrarian of voices. To support Gatsby in public, was to risk the cross-class side-eye from your academic rival, the sneers and jeers from your much more jaded and cynical classmate brooding in the corner of the room, one AirPod still firmly lodged in ear, that smooth operator who could never imagine being so naive as to fall for Gatsby's vulgar charade. The consensus was clear. Gatsby was an amoral egomaniac who treated others as disposable pawns in a chess match that only he could win. Supporting Gatsby was at best intellectually dishonest, at worst a sign of deep moral squalor. You were instantly labeled as suspicious and would have been subjected to the harshest forms of adolescent social exile. You'd go several hours without being on the receiving end of that complex finger-snapping technique that every guy in the sophomore class mastered in 2017. You'd have no one to spontaneously punch you in the arm, and you inevitably lost the circle game. And during passing time, you'd neither give nor receive daps. But despite fierce opposition, the pro-Gatsby crowd persisted. The one argument you kept hearing from those brave souls who dared to publicly support Gatsby focused on Gatsby's fundamental humanity. Sure, he may be a con man, but something about him felt real. Yes, he was deeply flawed, but aren't we all? Who are we to judge? Sure, he was a bit rough around the edges, materialistic, maybe a little shallow, but something about his love for the famously flaky Daisy Buchanan felt authentic, respectable, and maybe even kind of inspired. After all, he devoted his entire existence to this woman. Could any of us really claim with any certainty that we were as committed to anything or anyone as much as Gatsby was committed to Daisy Buchanan? And so something interesting began to happen when we got about 3/4 of the way through the novel. The pro-Gatsby quarter started to gain credibility and possibly a few new followers. Gatsby's original defenders began to speak with more authority. As Fitzgerald guided us through the seamy underbelly of roaring 20s America, we started really listening to the Gatsby fans, who had been saying all along that he's at least no worse than the environment he's a part of, and possibly even better in some ways. Gatsby had built an empire from scratch. He had pulled himself up from his bootstraps and transformed his life through sheer grit and passion. Maybe, just maybe, those who were so quick to denigrate Gatsby were possibly a little jealous of his power of devotion, his capacity to dream big, his ability to truly go all in on something because he really believed in it. As we neared the end of the novel, the trend continued. We were now looking at something like an even 50-50 split between the pro and anti-Gatsby factions. The suspicion that existed between the two groups had vanished, and suddenly there was something like an open exchange of ideas happening. The anti-Gatsby crowd was now open to persuasion and no longer dismissing the rivals out of hand. When we returned to the question of Gatsby's greatness in our final class on the unit, students dug into their books one last time to make their closing arguments. I remember vividly the final statement of one group who made the seemingly wild claim that Gatsby's greatness ultimately came down to his ability to eventually change his mind and recognize the humanity in others. Although this was quite a claim to make about a home-wrecking bootlegger who hobnobs with gangsters and criminals, they didn't blink. To show his evolution, they recalled when a much younger Gatsby first discovers that he can climb to the heights of American society, but only if he can climb alone. The group referred to this line not only to reveal the loneliness that lies at the heart of Gatsby's vision, a vision that ultimately offers no space for anyone else to share in his glory, but also as a point of contrast to the older Gatsby, who had adopted a much different perspective. The ruthless and solitary figure was not the final version of Gatsby, they claimed. To suggest otherwise was to ignore his obvious evolution. So their ultimate case for Gatsby's moral transformation rested on one scene near the end of the book. After going an entire summer without using a swimming pool, Gatsby invites Nick Carraway, the narrator of the novel, to spend some quality time with him, to relax and enjoy the last warm day of the summer, and just hang out without any ulterior motives. In this scene, so went their closing argument, Gatsby's invitation to Nick suggests that he finally learns to see other people as actual human beings with their own dreams, desires, and complicated truths. In this scene, right at the end of his life, Gatsby finally lets down his guard, forgets about Daisy for 2 seconds, and validates someone else's humanity, and he's rewarded with a brief moment of spiritual tranquility immediately before his tragic end. Pretty much everyone found the argument really compelling. Even if you weren't fully converted, the pro-Gatsby group had gained respect and even some mainstream acceptance. I remember being stunned for several days after hearing this interpretation. How had I never seen this? Here was a group of high school sophomores who were able to see what I never could, that any claim to Gatsby's true greatness came not from his wealth or his rags-to-riches story or even his capacity to dream big, but from his ability to change his mind and begin to see other people not as means to an end, but as ends in themselves. So what makes the class of 2020 special? In my memory, it's your ability to challenge established thinking, to locate the counterintuitive truth, to take seriously and treat with dignity, not just your own dreams, but the dreams of those around you. Thank you to the class of 2020 for teaching me the great Gatsby and reminding me that when our humanity is tested, we do well by ourselves when we recognize and affirm the humanity in others. Congratulations to the class of 2020, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to celebrate with you. Thank you.
Dear graduating seniors, as I set about composing this farewell address to you to offer some departing wisdom, one thought stuck in my head, not blind to the irony, that you will receive your diplomas in masks, with only your eyes showing, only your eyes. So how cool is it that you are the class of 2020? To prepare this send-off to you, officially called the Baccalaureate Address, I consulted the most reliable go-to, Urban Dictionary, just to make sure I had the 2020 thing right. I chose the top pick, submitted by a dude or dudette by the name of the Wise Janitor. So I knew right away the entry would be clean, though quickly discovered sweeping generalities. hey, we all have floors. And it states that 2020 is a phrase used to describe the fact that it's easy for one to be knowledgeable about an event after it has happened. And it continues, an individual has a realization about the event that should have been obvious all along, yet they didn't catch on because they were acting in the heat of the moment. Finally, the polished passage concludes with, it also allows one to learn from their mistakes, and ends with an example. After looking back on a situation, Jim realized that quitting his job was a foolish act, and even tags on a bit of riveting dialogue. Jim, Dad, why did you let me quit my job without interceding? Dad, hindsight is 2020, son. Learn from your mistakes. But the significance of 2020 begged to be explored further. Since I viewed the Urban Dictionary definition as rather backward, I needed more insight and found it in the fact that 2020 also signifies perfect vision. With a shift of a tassel, you will move from Lincoln Academy student to alumni, placing the lid on 13 years of formal education. Lashed to desks, highbrow or lowbrow, you have proven yourself good pupils. No doubt you feel as if the time has elapsed in a blink of an eye. Many of you will cap your experience with mortars emblazoned with personal images and words. Thanks, Mom or Dad, SpongeBob, or the latest meme to distinguish yourself from your peers. After all, you're all individuals, all eyes. Wicked. And you're all looking ahead to taking the first steps on your chosen paths. My bud Vincent, drying off from a 2-year soak at Bath Vocational, will be repairing cars in town. Exhausting work. Aria, will study marine biology. She's been hooked after spending 4 years in a Malaysian coast and really came out of her shell after 6 weeks interning at one of our local oyster farms. And my man Sam will swim, but also pool his energy, with any stroke of luck, to become a physician. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Yet, each of you is also a we, forever a member of Lincoln Academy, a hodgepodge of incongruous buildings clustered around an artificial turf field of recycled Nike soles, and perhaps, unseen to the outside observer, a common ethos, which may sound a bit hackneyed to you at this point, tolerance, acceptance, respect. Now, you may also recall from Mr. Page's Friday morning historical quizzes that from 1805 to 1903, ending just over a decade before the influenza pandemic, L.A. was a sending school for Bowdoin College, but for philosophical and financial reasons, opened its doors to all surrounding towns. Anyone, no matter background or future prospects, could attend. The farmer and the fisherman now rubbed elbows with the financier and fine arts aspirant. But our LA predecessors and current staff had the foresight to create over the years opportunities for each of you to interact with and learn from each other, to share your talents and failures, successes on the sports fields, in the band room, on stage in a Poe, at the annual art show, in advisories and clubs, robotics, MUN, debate, library team, board gaming and outing, each Friday morning at community meeting, and especially in your classes. They designed these social architectures because they knew, as have such divergent wisdom teachers from Confucius to Chaucer, Jesus to Jung, Einstein to Elmo, that the well-being of an individual, family, and community, a county, region, state, and country, and indeed the world, rests on our shared ability to get along and care for each other. Especially now, as the recent pandemic has proven, in an increasingly global society, a virtual cacophony of values, opinions, and systems, not to mention a creeping monetization of such basic needs as health, education, and clean air and water. How to achieve this perfect vision, this universal harmony, you may ask? Continue not to read each other with only your eyes, but rather to listen with your whole being. Sort of like Debussy and Mozart intoned as listening to the silence between the notes. What psychologist Carl Rogers refers to as active listening. So as you encounter the sundry pilgrims, your fellow travelers on this spaceship Earth, in garages and in grocery stores, on oceans and on land, in doctor's offices and restaurants, rich and poor, young and old, conservative and liberal, each has an accent. A complex amalgam of genetic and experiential factors to take into account. Now, if we see the role of what Williams James refers to as the judging spectator, to take off our masks and shut our eyes, every social interaction is an opportunity to enjoy spiritual and intellectual growth, what C.S. Lewis refers to as expanding one's human geometry. And as your math teachers have taught you, opposite angles, angles that are opposite each other when two lines cross, are also known as vertical angles, because the two angles share the same corner. Opposite angles are also congruent angles, meaning that they are equal or have the same measurement. Is it accidental that the word human derives from humus, meaning dirt, from which we ourselves derive? Perhaps the cultivation of ourselves also cultivates others? Sure, your years of schooling have required you to absorb a lot of facts, learn a trade, and hone reasoning skills, but also something more, a liberal education, two words whose origins evoke freedom, free to hold two opposing ideas at the same time, and free to be human beings capable of love and imagination, to hear the silence between the notes, not just our own echoes. In short, to distinguish knowledge from wisdom. Well, it's almost time to sign off, but I will leave you with a Confucian fortune cookie. When three of us are walking, I am bound to find my teacher there. I would single out the good points in others and try to follow them, and I would notice their bad points and try to correct myself. We raise our glasses to Lincoln Academy, class of 2020.
Congratulations, class of 2020. You've all passed the test that you are able to graduate during the time of pandemic. So gold stars to everybody. Congratulations. I'm sure it hasn't been an easy time. It hasn't been an easy time for anyone, but in particular, I'm sure you're sick of everyone saying, oh, it's such a shame you're missing these milestones, like the prom and the graduation. And yes, it is a pity. Of course it's a pity, but your life is super long. I don't mean that in like a depressing way, like it's good long. But you're gonna find so many things, so many discoveries in life that this will be a huge moment, in your life when you look back on this, but it's also going to be a badge of honor that you lived through this time and that you were the first class to essentially enter the workforce and take on the responsibility of basically patching up this post-pandemic world. Huge responsibility, but I'm sure you're up to it. And the challenge alone is probably something you're gonna wanna step up to. And we all thank you for that, because who knows what tomorrow's gonna bring. But I do know that the world is big, your life is long, not tediously long, like I said before. Wonderfully long, with thousands and thousands of experiences, probably millions, depends on, you know, let's decide like what an experience is, but I mean, lots of experiences, let's just say lots of experiences that you're going to have in your life. And this, yes, it was a hiccup, but let's move forward, onward and upward. We are so proud of you. And yes, we live in Italy now, and we're not back in the States right now with you, but we are so incredibly proud of you. I feel like a local because that's where I was born and raised. I went to Lincoln Academy and graduated in like 1774, just before the social studies majors can tell me what happened 2 years later. This is part of the test also. I know the answer, by the way. I'm just teasing. But do I? I do. Anyway, congratulations to all of you. I'm sending you a virtual toast that you just hold on to for 3 more years. Just keep it in your mouth and then swallow it in 3 years because it's not legal to do it now. Thinking of you and hope to see you all soon. We're really hoping to get back to Maine this summer, and maybe we'll see you on a river or on a lake or at the beach or Who knows? We won't recognize each other because we have masks on our face, but that time will pass too. Cheers. Thinking of you. Congratulations.
Good evening, faculty and families, and especially Lincoln Academy's graduating class of 2020. For those of you who do not know me, my name is Ryan Gall, class of 2019. 2019, gosh, seems like just yesterday I was graduating from Lincoln Academy, valedictorian of my class, 4 years of varsity in 3 different sports. Whew, prom king, I mean, accepted into 4 different Ivy League schools. How did I choose which whole, oh, I'm sorry. That was a mistake. That was a random speech that I found online. I Googled baccalaureate speeches and I found that. That was the wrong one. I apologize. Truth is, I graduated in 1992. With very few accolades. An interesting fact, I started growing this mustache the day I received my diploma. It's just coming in. Okay, so elephant in the room. This is all weird. Everything kind of sucks right now. Excuse my language. Kind of sucks. It kind of stinks. Can we just take a moment and acknowledge that? I'm just going to hold for a second. I ask you to do this. Turn to somebody in the room. You can pause this if you have to. And I want you to seriously just pause it and look at them in the eye and just say, this sucks. This stinks. I'll do it too. I'm going to do it with my cat, Tripper. Tripper! This stinks! He agrees. All right, I'll wait, pause, unpause. Here we go. Okay, we got that out of the way. So this is what I'm going to tell you. The world right now, it's changing incredibly fast. Everything is changing incredibly fast, and it seems more unpredictable than ever. It's hard to make a plan for next weekend, let alone your entire life. The stakes of everything because of what's happening just feel like they're higher. So because of that, people are going to do this. It's instinct. People are going to tell you to be careful. Everyone, relatives, teachers, other students, friends, be careful. Be careful. You leave the house in the morning, be careful. You leave the house at night, be careful. You go off to college, be careful. You get a job out of high school, be careful. Everyone's going to say it. No. I'm going to tell you, no, do not be careful. Do not be careful. This is not the time. It's not the time to be careful. Make some mistakes. That's what I'm going to do. And I want to tell you, as you leave all these situations, where you go out at night, you go out in the morning, I want to say, hey, go ahead, make some mistakes. And don't get me wrong, I want you to be healthy, I want you to be safe, I want you to wear your seatbelt. But really what I'm saying is, if you have a chance to do something big, travel. Or take a big job. Open a business. Do something anything that terrifies you. Ask somebody out. There are people watching this right now that are like, oh my god, I never asked him out. Or, I should have asked her out. It's not too late. Ask him out. Go get coffee. Get to know him. Ask him out! Who cares? Who cares? You gotta swing. And that's what I'm gonna tell you. Swing. Swing the bat. The pitches are gonna keep coming at you. But you have to swing the bat. And go for the home run. Don't just watch it go by. The hits will come. You will strike out a lot. Trust me. You will strike out a lot. But then you will start to hit. You might get a home run. Maybe you get a home run on the first swing. I don't know. But you have to swing. When I look back, this is honest. When I look back on the last 28 years of my life, I can't believe it's been 28 years since I graduated high school. That, did you see that? There was like throw up came up to like right here. I'm okay now. But seriously, when I look back at failures and successes, and the failures definitely outweigh the successes, I learned most when I failed. It's always confused me why we're afraid to fail if that's where you're gonna learn the most. In the moment, it always feels like garbage to fail. It does not feel good. But you take it with you, and the next time the ball comes, the next time an opportunity comes and you have the chance to swing, you're a little bit smarter, and you're a little bit wiser, and you're a little bit stronger. And I know what you're thinking, right? Hey, Ryan, come on. You've never failed. How can you're talking down to us. Come on. No, that's not true. That's not true. I think, listen, what's the elephant? The elephant number two in the room right now is this guy. Look at this thing. Come on. So let me show you. Let's fix this right now. Let me show you. There are going to be times in your life where you make a choice. You make a choice and you're like, oh no. Oh, crap. What did I do? What did I do? You can always start over. You can always go back and you can always... gosh. Reset. 99% of the time. You can always make up for a failure by deciding to make a new choice. I mean, look at what's going on. That was 28 years of mustache growth. I mean, so the next time you do something and you go, oh, shouldn't have done that. Know that you can start over. Go back to the beginning and start over. You get one chance. One chance at this life that we know of. So don't be afraid to start over. Don't be afraid to fail. Holy cow, man. I look like a news reporter or something now. Maybe I should have kept it. But that's the thing. Now I can grow it back out. What's 28 years? Listen, congratulations to Lincoln Academy's graduating class of 2020. If you ever find yourself in Los Angeles, please reach out. Please reach out and say something to me. I'd love to have you as my guest at the Groundlings Theater. I wish all of you all the success in the world as you go forward. And don't forget, if you have a chance, just fail at a few things. Just fail at a few things. Hey, go Eagles! Go Eagles!
Greetings to all of you, friends of Lincoln Academy, joining us virtually from all over the world for this most unique of baccalaureate ceremonies. But it's you, the class of 2020, that I offer my most heartfelt welcome and thanks for this opportunity to speak to you today. You're the class I started with at Lincoln Academy, and so this was kind of my senior year too. Isn't it how any of us would have expected it to end? But even if we can't get together physically for it, the baccalaureate tradition serves as a milestone and a touchstone, helping us to look back, to look around, and to look ahead, keeping in mind the principles and the spirit of what we've learned together. I'm recording my message from the lighthouse at Pemaquid Point, not just because it's a part of the fabric of our community, or an iconic image on the main state quarter, or because it's as far as I could isolate from Academy Hill and still be on the peninsula, or not even because our school was founded 26 years before this lighthouse was commissioned. I chose it because an aid to navigation like this one symbolizes the kind of work we try to do in the health center. The way ahead isn't always clear from sea level. We can't lay out a safe and predictable path for you through high school. We can provide you with key pieces of information and some warning signs. As Mr. Page has always said, boats are safe in the harbor, but that's not what boats are for. And if you learn some things along the way, you'll go from one place to the next a little more safely. Well, then I realized that your high school graduation coincides with the 30th anniversary of my own high school graduation. I hadn't the faintest idea back then that I would be speaking with you today, or that I would be doing so after spending my career at some intersection of education and wilderness trip leading and emergency medical care. So as I asked myself, what advice would I give to me when I graduated high school? What advice has proven solid? What have I learned from my own mistakes that might be worth sharing? And what do I hope still holds true in this whole new world we're all inhabiting now? Took a lot of deleting and a lot of thinking, but this process of self-reflection is something that I'm going to value for some time to come. And it reminded me that it was 4 years ago that the students of this venerable institution voted me as the person they would want most on their zombie apocalypse team. So here are a few insights that I have gained through our time together since. Practice good manners. Make them instinctive. This is one of the most efficient and useful and effective tools that you can have in your quiver. It's different than charm, which can be wielded more deceitfully. What I mean is that good manners are honest. Saying you're sorry when you've been a doofus is not about admitting you're weak. It's an acknowledgement of respect. You should trust your instincts of self-preservation. I've suggested to you many times before that if you find yourself wondering if you should have on a helmet, a seatbelt, a condom, or nowadays a mask, stop what you're doing, modify your plan until you can act it out more safely. It's easier to stay well than it is to get well. And even nice people have microbes that we don't want to share. And even people we love very much do short-sighted and dangerous things sometimes. And even though the probability of getting sick or hurt is low and you can feel invincible, you're not. And some of the consequences of those kinds of decisions affect all of us for a long time. Because suffering is universal. It's unjust, it's bewildering, and it's heart-wrenching. But pain and suffering are facts of life that must be engaged because they cannot be avoided. You're not weak, it's not your fault, and getting angry about it can be toxic. Instead, cherish how the line between laughter and tears is thin and it's malleable. While keeping in mind that not all suffering is accidental, not all suffering is existential. Sometimes it's the direct result of willful behavior by others and selfishness and greed, ill intent, even societal structures. And these things should prompt us to action, should motivate us to intervene and develop a moral compass that guides us every day towards making this crazy world just a little bit better. One interaction, one purchase, one vote, one child at a time. We need to learn to take feedback gracefully and even gratefully. You will not get it right the first time, every time. Accept your mistakes, figure out what went wrong and how you're gonna do it differently. Wits and book learning are only part of this equation. Good judgment builds on those through experience, and experience usually involves making way more mistakes for a long time than you have successes.
Know what you know, and know it well. But know what you don't know, and that you don't know it all, and be willing to accept that and admit it. My last piece of advice to you is cut yourself some slack. The last time I checked, you were human, and I know them to be a complicated species. They tend to make mistakes and seem rough and unsettled at times. But though we all look differently on the outside, we all look the same on the inside, and we each carry our own pain through life. So you, me, us, them, we're same, only different. We are each and all fighting our own hard battle. So err on the side of self-acceptance and foster that in other people. Being here reminds me of one of the first lessons you learn in maritime navigation. And it's a story about a radio transmission that was recorded in the 1940s. This boat looks out through the fog and in the dark, and it sees a light and thinks that it's another boat. And it says, "We're a bigger boat, you must give way." And they go back and forth. "We can't give way, you must give way. We can't give way, you must give way." "This is the HMS Britannia, and we are the largest vessel, and in the name of the Queen, I order you to give way." The final reply comes back in a thick Irish brogue, and it says, "Sure, call upon whomever you want, Captain, but we're a lighthouse." Just navigate what you can for now. Get around the point. Go as far as you can and reassess. There's another harbor right around that next point waiting for you. And you always need to know that you're welcome home at this one too. Alas, I have run out of time. If I were in person, I would now turn to regaling you with all the secrets of my significant skills in the prediction of snow days, as many of you have asked, but I can't. And so instead, I'm gonna leave you in a spirit of gratitude, and I'm gonna humbly ask you to remember something. Kindness is cool. Compassion is a verb, and community matters now more than ever. Congratulations, class of 2020. Know that you will always hold a place as my own senior class at Lincoln Academy. Stay well.